henna, 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 hey, henna, 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 hey.
I am henna, very proud. Henna, very proud to be a Lumbee Indian.
Hey, henna, 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 hey.
I know henna, who I am.
Henna, henna, hey.
Maybe we are being forgotten.
Henna, hey.
This is Mother Earth. You can't live without the earth.
We know who we are. We have always known who we are. Space, flowers, fields, the river.
There's no one thing that is true. It is all true.
The river. The white man calls it the Lumber River, but to the Indians, it's the Lumbee, and it defines who they are. They are the people of the dark water. I'm David Crabtree. Dark, murky, mysterious, it describes the river and the people who live along it. But just who are these people? One of the largest tribes in the country, largest east of the Mississippi, and the largest unrecognized tribe. The federal government doesn't fully recognize the Lumbee Indians. Their identity has been blurred, their history questioned. It's a rich history. The Lumbee Indians, who take their name from the river, the people of the dark water.
You can feel it. This is where I need to be. I know who I am.
You're right here now in the Indian territory. There's a difference here. Don't you think so?
40,000 Lumbee Indians live in Robeson County in the southeastern part of North Carolina. More Indians than any other race.
I know that's hard for you to believe, but that's facts. Now, if I didn't know it, I couldn't tell it. We've come a long ways, baby.
Some Lumbees live in Lumberton, but most live here, Pembroke.
The town of Pembroke is typical small-town America. It's just a close-knit community.
Almost 95% of the population is Lumbee.
Those are prevalent names in this area. Locklear, Lowry, Hunt, Oxendine, Dow, Brooks, Cummings, all Lumbees. You know, it's strictly Lumbee over here.
Milton Hunt is the mayor of Pembroke.
Born in town and never lived outside the city limits. If I didn't like it, I wouldn't live here. You know, I thought you were gonna ask me about my hazel eyes. So I thought that was ironic. But we are Lumbees, and we're proud of it. Let me tell you this story. My great-grandfather, he and a group delivered the first petition to Washington for federal recognition in the 1888. The process is simple. We've been at it, what, 109 years now? How long do we have to wait? You know, why don't we need federal recognition? We need it just like any other tribe does. Yes, we deserve it just like anybody else.
What the Lumbees don't have, the Cherokee Indians do. You can't help but compare them. Both are from North Carolina. Two tribes, one state, worlds apart.
We've compromised ourselves many years ago.
Just plain luck.
Cherokee, North Carolina.
Oh, I think it's great. But it's definitely more fun when you win.
The Eastern Band of the Cherokee Indians owns this casino.
I think it's great for the Cherokees. Maybe it's some way for them to get some kind of an income.
Income, but at what price? The Cherokees are federally recognized. It's their identity that may be slipping away.
If you break even, you've won.
I think we compromised our culture 50 years ago. But it is a means towards economic survival.
Joyce Dugan, principal chief of the Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians.
When you weigh out a life of poverty, for example, against any means that you have at your disposal to make a living, then you choose the latter.
We know who we are. We have always known who we are.
So you're going to be a Lumbee forever.
It's a miracle that there are any Indians left in North Carolina, given what they've been subjected to. It's a miracle.
Lumbees are still fighting for federal recognition. It's a battle they haven't yet won. Critics point out they don't live on a reservation, they have never signed a treaty with the federal government, and they can't prove they are all descendants of the same tribe. In effect, they don't meet certain criteria. But the Lumbees say it's not about criteria at all. It's about perception.
The Western notion of Indians is this one thing. It's this guy on a horse. The problem is the stereotype.
It's home. It's people that look like I look. It's people that talk the way I talk. I know his mama, his daddy. We have a history together that goes all the way back.
Lunchtime at Lindy's.
What, we got doctors, lawyers. We've made it because we were not put on a reservation. And we're like diamonds. God didn't make many of them. And we're the best of the lot right here in Pembroke.
They say the Jewish people is God's chosen people, but I look at us Native Americans the same way. I would rather be a Lumbee than any nationality that I know of.
It's a closeness. It's hard to explain. I think it's more inherent, born into you. You know, I think that maybe that's why.
If I see Raymond in Raleigh, we have an instant bond as being Lumbee and from the same community, and that's sort of a bond that's always there. Have a seat, Mike.
Who are you with, Mike?
I don't know if I'd go so far as say if it's genetic, but I think it's inherent in us somehow. I don't know.
Got your freedom down there.
We're not where we want to be, but we dang sure ain't where we were either. I wrote Jesse Helms a letter, and one of the phrases I put in there is sad when the first Americans have to ask the second Americans to recognize them as people. I'm sure recognition would have went through. It would have been a done deal had it not been for Jesse Helms. But we survived just the same. So we are progressing. And we're doing it as a people.
The federal government says in the 1956 Lumbee Act, yes, we recognize you as Indians, but we're not going to give you anything for it. It is, in effect, recognition and termination in the same breath.
The Lumbees are the largest Indian tribe in the country without full federal recognition. But they have come close, falling just two votes shy in 1992 in the U.S. Senate. Jesse Helms was behind that failure, partially because federal recognition means federal funding for things such as education and health care. Senator Helms says adding the Lumbees would simply cost the government too much money. In any case, the Lumbees go on fighting and failing. No, they don't have federal recognition, but many insist they have something far more important, their identity.
When people don't know who they are or where they came from, a whole lot don't matter to them anymore.
Carl Anthony Hunt, an artist painting a picture of Lumbee life.
Yeah, he's a Lumbee. This is a man who I saw, instead of waiting for his government rations to come out every month like they do on the reservations, that he went out and made a way for his family. That's a hero. That's the American dream, you know what I mean? I'm trying to help tear down barriers, all these stereotypes and stuff. We are educated way before any other Indian tribe. All this stuff, hey, we done it. We have never had a problem with identity. It's the powers that be that try to deny our identity. People recognize, don't recognize, so what? But yet we know who we are. I don't care what nobody says, we've always been here. It is us. I mean, you can't see down in it.
It's like you don't know what's under the surface, kind of like our history.
Such a God who created a place as this needs no lesser cathedral. So leave me here to learning my lessons in solitude, near God, by the Lumbee River, my flowing temple.
Native people have been here all along. Probable links to Hatteras, which is the link to the Lost Colony. The Lost Colony, of course, is supposed to have disappeared in the late 1580s while John White was gone back to England for supplies. When he returns and finds the word Croatoan carved and can't find them, goes back without them, the colony's declared lost. Well, the presumption is that some of these Indians intermarried with some of these colonists and migrated into this area.
Are the Lumbee Indians really descendants of the lost colonists? At one time, they were in fact known as the Croatan Indians. Another mystery, the Lumbee's past as murky as the river. The pain of the past. There are dark chapters in Lumbee history. It's recent history, a time in the 1980s when order began to unravel.
We shall
there had been a series of unsolved murders.
The shooting of Lumbee Indian Jimmy Cummings set people off.
It was a time of some tension.
Once again, an Indian is shot and killed by a Robeson County Sheriff's deputy.
We had gotten to a critical mass.
We're not laying the blame on any one person or any two persons. We're blaming it on a system.
It was a tense time. There's no doubt about it.
And things got worse. Robeson County actually captured worldwide headlines. In the winter of 1988, the local newspaper, the Robesonian, suddenly became the news.
February the 1st, 1988, about 10 a.m.
Bob Horn was the Robesonian's editor.
Somebody came in and burst into my office and said, there's a holdup up front. I saw fear that day that in people's faces that I've never seen before.
10-4, your backup.
Police in Lumberton needed plenty of backup today as they surrounded the local newspaper building. They found out there was no holdup. Instead, 17 people had been taken hostage inside the Robesonian.
The other guy pulled out a gun. It looked like a pump shotgun, sawed-off shotgun.
Eddie Hatcher is real hyper. I knew him as a local Indian activist. He was shouting and screaming. He was sweating profusely. He would walk over and lay his head down on a safe for a few seconds. And late in the morning, maybe by 11 o'clock, he's telling us we need to get the governor on the phone by noon. Even if the governor had been calling, he couldn't have gotten through because all the lines were tied up.
Eddie Hatcher.
Eddie, this is Charlie Gaddy. How are you?
Well, it's a tense situation, and it's getting more tense by the hour. That dark's coming, and I'm afraid that they're going to make an unwise move. We have doors barricaded. At sunset, if necessary, we'll cut all lights. So if any shots are fired in here, no one will know who's getting shot. But once the shots start, then it goes full blast.
We were not observers in this event. We were participants, unwilling participants, but we were participants.
Demanding racial justice in Robeson County.
They don't feel like the law enforcement in this county can be trusted.
We demand that the governor of North Carolina immediately initiate an investigation into the corrupt Robeson County government.
How much, if any, of it was real, or how much was his own paranoia, I have no idea.
They threw their weapons out the back door of the Robesonian newspaper office. They released their last hostages and then gave themselves up.
I'm just tickled to death. It's over. No one was harmed.
Sometimes I think that you have to have confrontation before you can really get progress. I feel like there is progress there now. At the same time, I don't agree with what they did or how they did it. Although, I do think that it was a part of something good.
Eddie Hatcher and Tim Jacobs both went to prison on kidnapping charges. The state investigated their claims of government corruption, but in the end found no evidence. Much has changed since then. Today, Robeson County's sheriff is a Lumbee Indian.
9156. Car 1 to Robeson.
Glenn Maynard.
28 when you're ready.
The first Native American ever elected sheriff in Robeson County.
it's harder for a Native American to be sheriff than anybody else in this county, because the microscope is pretty well on me at all times, and people expect more of me. The turmoil is not in our county anymore the way it was at one time. And I mean, there were tension in this county on top of tension, you know. It's just everything's positive now. I get emotional when I talk a lot of times, because I'm a Christian. I got another philosophy, you know, the biggest mistake that we can make in life is to forget where we come from. You know, a lot of times I ride along and just look up and say, thank you, Jesus, you know, for everything. Because good always outweighs evil. As low and as bad as things get some days, that tomorrow is going to be a better day. And it's been happening, you know. It's been happening.
People just change, you know. Don't look like they don't much care anymore. If everybody could pull together, you know, it would be fine. They, I guess, different races have problems, you know, with one another. I'm just, you know, proud to be, you know, what I am. Yeah.
The spirit of the Native American as resilient, and this sort of American spirit of the pioneer, the person who survives, the person who endures and goes ahead. In 1958, the Klan decided that it needed to come to Robeson County and put things, quote, right. You know, come to the big rally. Lumbees heard about it. Some number of Lumbee men went to the rally. Apparently there was a scuffle, some firing of shots, fisticuffs, and so apparently the Klan left. It is a signpost along the way, a signpost that reads, tread lightly here. We're serious. We know who we are. We're a community. We're proud.
I'm glad I'm what I am. Well, I'd rather be that than anything else. Don't you think so?
Isaiah Locklear, 98 years old.
I come up with the ox and cart days. Open house, just weatherboarding. Of course, at that time we were eating out the kitchen. And you know what we're doing now? Eating out of paper sacks and tin cans. That's facts now. You know I know what I'm talking. Improved? What you talking? The Indian folks has made great progress in my day. I'm just trying to show you the progress. But I've had a good life. You believe that? Yeah.
Is this a heartbeat?
Reggie Brewer is a teacher.
This is what we use to survive. We survive through this drum.
Teaching the drum.
Everything revolves in a circle. That's why that drum is a circle. It's something that's in me that I can never get away from. We're here, we're in this.
Water here, you ask me, God, don't we? See, huh? The land that we have here is—it's beautiful. It's a beautiful land.
Western North Carolina, home to the Eastern Band of the Cherokee Indians.
I sell Indian merchandise and moccasins. Typical day, we're wide open.
It's commercialism. That's what it is. Mm-hmm. Pretty soon, they become just like us.
A trail of tourists. $2 million a year. They come to Cherokee for the Indian experience. But do they get it?
I don't understand your question. If you're wanting to find somebody living in a teepee, no, I don't think so. You won't find a true Cherokee. Nobody lives in a Stone Age anymore.
The tourists want to see that. They want to see an Indian with feathers. That's what they get.
I've been right here for 39 years.
Chief Lightfoot, full-blooded Cherokee.
Half-breeds. There's a lot of half-breeds around here. And $3 for one snap. Those little bit of snapshots. And ain't got rich yet.
I would venture to say if you came into town and you left here without a pair of moccasins, that you really didn't get the experience.
They want to see teepees, that's what they get. It's not accurate, no.
We compromised our culture 50 years ago.
Lumbees drive cars and trucks, you know. They wear blue jeans and three-piece suits. They might not conform to somebody's movie notion of what an Indian ought to be, but in every other sense of the word, they do. Nobody ever asks white people, are you full-blooded white?
Dr. Stanley Nick, a white man in an Indian world. Nick runs the Native American Resource Center at UNC Pembroke.
You know, nobody ever says, are you full-blooded black? Are you full-blooded white? And that's ironic, considering that, after all, they were here first. Throughout the government's policy, there have been two rules. Whatever you do, act like you're the daddy and the Indians are the children. Rule number two, always be inconsistent. Never do the same thing twice. Always change the rules. Every 10 years, make a new policy, do something different. Move the goalposts, move it over here, move it over there. This is the way the government has played the game with Indians. The government's notion of who the Indians are is such a narrow vision. It is such a stereotype that it's no wonder that some people don't seem to fit that package. The problem is the stereotype more than who the real Indians are. They are living a traditional culture. People with a sense of history, people with a sense of pride, people with a very strong sense of family and religion. That's what I see.
I feel very close to God here. I see him in the trees. I see him swimming in the dark waters here. It is a symbol of hope.
The God who created the sky and this black water created the Indian people too. We know who we are. We have always known who we are.
In many ways, the Lumbees are like a river people cross every day but never stop to look at. They blend in unnoticed, no longer recognized for who they are. Will the Lumbees ever be fully recognized, federally recognized? Congress is debating it again. Their future is unknown, dark and mysterious, like the river that gives them their name. Lumbee, people of the dark water.
It's our identity, who we are, is who we are as a people. There's a good spirit here. A lot of people died for this place, and it's a real strong feeling. So the fight goes on. It's just a love for who I am.
Hey,